you're in a tussle with somebody, you're already in it, and they pull a knife or they pull something, that's when you're going to try to abandon that fight, make known your desire for peace by word or act, and then assess that situation and react accordingly.
Okay, so I'm in a fight with somebody. All right, let's say you're in a brawl in a bar or something, right? You've got two guys involved, let's say three, and you're in a fist fight. Mm. One guy pulls a knife. What you're telling me is even if I'm armed with my handgun, with my concealed weapons permit, I have not been drinking, they're attacking me, the guy pulls a knife, I have to retreat in order to use my firearm under those circumstances?
Yeah, you're going to have to be able to retreat as far as possible. So again, that comes down to a reasonableness standard. You know, what is retreating under that circumstance? You know, we can get into the gray areas of the law. Is pushing your foot back one step a retreat? Yes. You know, so I think you have to have that ability to retreat. But if you cannot retreat, if there was no ability to retreat, you don't have that duty. So if your back's already against the wall, then you don't have that duty to retreat.
If your back is against the wall and he pulls out the knife, you're able to dislodge your weapon from your holster. You can shoot him. Mm-hmm. But the prosecutor is not going to be happy, is he?
No, it's still going to be a brandishing that they're looking into on top of the murder or manslaughter charge.
Mm-hmm. So under those circumstances, the guy has me pinned up. I start yelling out loud, listen, put the knife down, all right? I don't want to fight anymore. Put the knife down. Now am I protected?
Well, now you're getting closer to the excusable homicide because now you've made that articulation. I don't want to fight. Put the knife down. You're giving those loud verbal commands. You know, you've made known your intent to make peace, and again, now if he continues coming at you, you get to move further on that scale. Is there that reasonable apprehension of bodily harm, and what's the reasonable force that I need to use to repel that?
All right, fair enough. Dee, I think that's been a wonderful, wonderful discussion on bare bones law in Virginia. There are some cases in Virginia on point, right?
Yes, there are.
All right. Just take the readers through those cases for their own independent research.
McGee v. Commonwealth, 219 Virginia 560. That's a 1978 case. Commonwealth v. Sands, it's 262 Virginia 724. That's a 2001 case. Bailey v. Commonwealth, 200 Virginia 92. That's a 1958 case. Smith v. Commonwealth, 165 Virginia 776. That's a 1935 case. Newcomer v. Commonwealth, 220 Virginia 64. That's a 1979 case. Lamb v. Commonwealth, 141 Virginia 481. That's a 1925 case.
You know, when you need to go back to 1925 for the self-defense law in the state of Virginia, you know that these concepts are pretty well ingrained. They don't change very much, do they, Dee?
No, they don't.
Common law principles are at play for self-defense, am I right?
Yes, no, they are. So, and I mean, the self-defense claims that you would use in a homicide situation are the same that you would use in an assault situation. So, so the case law may be talking about one or the other.
Yep, fair enough. But the concepts are exactly the same. Right? I hope that the viewing audience has learned something about the Castle Doctrine, when lethal force is available for use by the citizen. The thing that I impress upon you guys, the listening audience, is know the pre-attack indicators. The next part of this video series is absolutely crucial for you. Know the pre-attack indicators and what you are looking for in assessing that imminent harm is going to befall you if you don't use your firearm. And we'll cut it here. Thank you so much, Mr. David Dishley, New York Times decorated former prosecutor, now an attorney at the Bose Law Firm. Thanks again, D.
Thanks.